Hello students, in the last class we discussed about Bertrand Russell. Today we will discuss his essay Knowledge and Wisdom. Most people would agree that although our age surpasses all previous ages in knowledge, there has been no correlative increase in wisdom, but agreement ceases as soon as we attempt to define wisdom and consider means of promoting it. I want to ask first what wisdom is and then what can be done to teach it. There are, I think, several factors that contribute to wisdom. Of these, I should put first a sense of proportion, the capacity to take account of all the important factors in a problem and to attach to each its due weight. This has become more difficult than it used to be owing to the extent and complexity of a specialized knowledge required of various kinds of technique. Suppose, for example, that you are engaged in search in scientific medicine. The work is difficult and is likely to absorb the whole of your intellectual energy. You have not time to consider the effect which your discoveries or invention may have outside the field of medicine. You succeed, let us say, as modern medicine has succeeded, innumerously lowering the infant death rate, not only in Europe and America, but also in Asia and Africa. This is an entirely unintended result of making the food supply inadequate and lowering the standards of life in the most populous parts of the world. To take an even more spectacular example, which is in everybody's mind at the present time, you study the composition of the atom from a disinterested desire for knowledge and incidentally place in the hands of powerful lunatics the means of destroying the human race. In such ways, the pursuit of knowledge may become harmful unless it is combined with wisdom. And wisdom in the sense of comprehensive reason is not necessarily present in specialists in the pursuit of knowledge. So, in this essay, Bertrand Russell says, knowledge and wisdom are different things. Wisdom does not come immediately with knowledge. As Tennyson observed, knowledge comes but wisdom lingers. Knowledge may sometimes even lead to unwisdom. To illustrate, which Russell cites two excellent examples. When men attain enough knowledge to lower the death rate among infants, population increased, food supplies became short and standard of living declined. Thus, lowering the death rate of children, in his opinion, was a mistake on the part of medical specialists. Military specialists also have landed in many such follies. He says that when men invented the technique of splitting atom, everyone began to think that mountains could now be moved and the courses of river and that of history could be changed, but instead of using this new gained knowledge for useful and beneficial purpose, men began to manufacture nuclear weapons even after witnessing the horrible mass genocide caused by them. Even the advanced as well as the barbarian countries of the world still go on manufacturing them. One day they will wipe out the human race from the face of the earth. Wisdom does not come with knowledge. These are the evil effects of specialization in singular subjects. It is from a comprehensive reason and sense of proportion that wisdom evolves. He says that comprehensiveness alone, however, is not enough to constitute wisdom. There must be also a certain awareness of the ends of human life. This may be illustrated by the study of history. Many eminent historians have done more harm than good because they viewed facts through the distorting medium of their own passions. Hegel had a philosophy of history which did not suffer from any lack of comprehensiveness. Since it started from the earliest time and continued into an indefinite future, but the chief lesson of history which he sought to inculcate was that from the year 1400 AD down to his own time, Germany had been the most important nation and the standard bearer of progress in the world. Perhaps one could stretch the comprehensiveness that constitutes wisdom to include not only intellect but also feeling. It is by no means uncommon to find men whose knowledge is wide but whose feelings are narrow. Such men lack what I call wisdom. He says, proper knowledge of human history also is needed to gain wisdom. Russell also says some history writings we see are distorted ones, fabricated with a view to inculcate some particular feelings or passions among people. People who wrote about Lenin were totally blind to the cruel politician assassination of his time, which gave rise to the theory of revolutions eating out its own children, evidenced by the death of Trotsky. He says that we sometimes may have been respected the man out of the knowledge that he was not a god, but only a man. It should be noted here that the greatest sins committed by Gandhiji, we all know Gandhiji, came to the world attention not by his opponents mentioning them, but from his own autobiography, which was rightly titled My Experiments with Truth. Gandhi never hesitated to tell the story of his stealing the gold bangle of his house servant to purchase liquor in his boyhood years. We only respect this people for the frankness and truthfulness with which he recorded his own follies. That is his greatness in India's example. That is how and why it came to be written India's official seal. Truth alone will triumph. When India became independent, great men were always truthful in recording their follies, along with English. Hegel wrote history to prove that the Germans were a master race from the time memorable. Such distorted recording of history lead to unwisdom and destruction. He says, Bertrand Russell says, even in land which it would be noble to pursue if we are attainable, may be pursued unwisely. If it is inherently possible of achievement, many men in past ages devoted their life to a search for the philosopher's stone and the elixir of life. No doubt, if they could have found them, they would have conferred great benefits upon mankind. But as it was, their lives were wasted. To descend to less heroic matter, consider the case of two men, Mr. John and Mr. B., who hate each other and through mutual hatred bring each other to destruction. Suppose you go to Mr. A. and say, why do you hate Mr. B.? He will no doubt you give an appalling list of Mr. B.'s vices, partly true, partly false. Now suppose you go to Mr. B. He will give you an exact similar list of Mr. A.'s vices with an equal admixture of truth and falsehood. Suppose you now come back to Mr. A. and say, you will be surprised to learn that Mr. B. says that same thing about you as you say about him. You go to Mr. B. and make a similar speech. The first effect, no doubt, will be to increase their mutual hatred, since each will be so horrified by the other's injustice. But perhaps, if you have sufficient patience and sufficient persuasiveness, you may succeed in convincing each other that the other has only the normal share of human wickedness and that their enmity is harmful to both. If you can do this, you will have instilled some fragment of wisdom. He said that wisdom has a key role to play in the private life of a man. Men, except on rare occasion, fails to see his future in advance. He seldom knows what the future has in store for him. He has to live beneficial to the world. Since mankind is a collective reality, animosity among its members cannot help it achieve the benefits of living. By practicing universal brotherhood, alone can man gain wisdom and live beneficial to the world and its inhabitants. So to set apart two quarreling friends would be an act of wisdom. If you can do this, you will have instilled some fragment of wisdom. Writes Russell, our private life should be filled with such little acts of wisdom. But millions of men, instead of going after this well-defined objective in their lives, have searched for the philosopher's stone and wasted their lives. No doubt, if they could have found them, they would have conferred great benefits on mankind, but it was their lives that were wasted. Russell warns us that we should not waste our lives on such impossible philosophical feats. We should instead fill it with small acts of wisdom. As we grow older, we will gain more impartiality. Our horizon will widen. Our thoughts and feelings will become less personal and more detached from our own physical state. It is that stage in human life which Shakespeare in his poem The Seven Stages of Man's Life described as the stage in which men begin to think and act like a judge. Thus, we gradually became freed of all selfish motives but began to think more for the society than for ourselves. He says, I think the sense of wisdom is emancipation. As far as possible from the tyranny of the here and now, we cannot help the egoism of our sense, sight and sound and touch, bound up with our own bodies and cannot be impersonal. Our emotions start similarly from ourselves. An infant feels hunger, discomfort, and is unaffected except by his own physical condition. Gradually, with the years, his horizon widens, and in proportion as his thoughts and feelings become less personal, less concerned with his own physical state, he achieves growing wisdom. This is, of course, a matter of degree. No one can view the world with complete impartiality, and if anyone could, he would hardly be able to remain alive. It is impossible to make a continual approach toward impartiality on the one hand, by knowing things somewhat remote in time or space, and on the other hand by giving to such things their due weight in our feeling. It is this approach toward impartiality that constitutes growth in wisdom. He says, according to Bertrand Russell, the emancipation of freedom from selfishness is the essence of wisdom. Wisdom can be taught like any other virtue. Even though we are born unwise, which we cannot help, we can cultivate wisdom. He then says, we are told on Sundays that we should love our neighbors or ourselves. On the other 6 days of the week, we are exhorted to hate. You may say that this is nonsense, since it is not our neighbor whom we are exhorted to hate, but you will remember that the precept was exemplified by saying that the Smartian was our neighbor. We no longer have any wish to hate Smartian, and so we are apt to miss the point of parable. If you want to get its point, you should substitute communist or anti-communist, as the case may be. For Smartian, it may be objected that it is right to hate those who do harm. I do not think so. If you hate them, it is only too likely that you will become equally harmful. It is very unlikely that you will induce them to abandon their evil ways. Hatred of evil is itself a kind of bondage to evil. The way out is through understanding, not through hate. I am not advocating non-resistance, but I am saying that resistance, if it is to be effective in preventing the spread of evil, should be combined with the greatest degree of understanding and the smallest degree of forces that is compatible with the survival of the good things that we wish to preserve. He says that Sunday school are not supposed to supply wisdom, they can only supplement wisdom. If we already have some, they can only make their wise men wiser. Thus, moral instruction and the teaching of wisdom differ much. Wisdom should be planted and nursed in one's own mind. We are living in a war-stricken world which needs wisdom. Therefore, wisdom should be taught by any means. We cannot all be good Smartians to our neighbors, but we can certainly reduce our hatred to others. It should be noted here that even nations are now unable to reduce their hatred to other nations. The Russian communists find they are unable to remain good Smartians to the American anti-communists. But in the midst of all this national hatred, a single man can remain wise when the whole world goes unwise. So hate hatred should be our slogan. It is indecent for a government to show hatred to other nations, to its people, because this world and the humanity is built up based on the principal forces of harmony. But the short-sighted, punny little mind that are the government in many countries cannot understand this, as they are nowhere near the much-dreamed concept of Plato's philosophical king. In many sister nations, even if the people like each other in their hearts, their government cultivate animosity and hatred. We can point out dozens of modern-day examples. As, for example, the government of India and Pakistan shout at each other and conduct war rehearsals, but the Indian music lover worship the Pakistani ghazal singers, many of them the stars of the Undivided India. Indian film stars are the favorite of Pakistani film goers. Both government view these admirers and fans suspiciously. But in the long run, it is not these short-living governments, but these admirers and fans of music, literature and films who keep these nations going and standing. That is the importance and relevance of a single man's stand in the midst of national lunacy. It is when such singular wisdom happened to fuse uniquely with vigor of action that the world was saved several times from near peril. He says, he gives the example of many historical personalities. He says, in history we see many examples of active vigor infusion with wisdom, forming powerful personalities, saving the world. We see Moses in the Bible professing the Ten Commandments before our people, too seduced to be saved, Queen Elizabeth I in England, King Henry IV in France, and Abraham Lincoln in America were very impressive personalities who fused vigor with wisdom and fought the evil. The world has had the luck to have many such personalities in among her people. Abraham Lincoln even conducted a civil war without ever departing from wisdom. It was his vigor of action and wisdom which helped him abolish slavery and prevent the northern and southern states of America from separating in the civil war. So we can say that according to Bertrand Russell, knowledge is defined as the acquisition of data and information, while wisdom is defined as a practical application and use of the knowledge to create value. Wisdom is gained through learning and practical experiences, not just memorization. A sense of proportion is very much necessary for wisdom. By inventing medicine, a scientist may reduce infant death rate. Apparently, it leads to a population explosion and a shortage of food. The standard of life comes down. If misused, knowledge of atoms can lead human to destruction by manufacturing a nuclear weapon. He says that knowledge without wisdom can be harmful. Even complete knowledge is not enough. For example, he gave the example of Hegel. He says that Hegel wrote with great knowledge about history but made the German believe that they were a master of race. It led to war. It is necessary, therefore, to combine knowledge with feeling. We need wisdom both in public and private life. We need the wisdom to decide the goal of our life. We need to free ourselves from personal prejudices. Wisdom is needed to avoid dislike for one another. Two persons may remain enemies because of their prejudice. If they can be told that we all have flaws, then they may become friends. So, Russell says, hate hatred should be our slogan. Wisdom lies in freeing ourselves from the control of our sense organs. Our ego develops through our senses. We cannot be free from the sense of sight, sound, and touch. We know the world primarily through our senses. As we grow, we discover that there are other things also. We start recognizing them. Thus, we give up thinking of ourselves alone. We start thinking of other people and grow wiser. We give up on our ego. Wisdom comes when we start loving others. Russell feels that wisdom can be taught as a goal of education. Even though we are born unwise, which we cannot help, we can cultivate wisdom. Queen Elizabeth I, Henry IV, and Abraham Lincoln are some impressive personalities who fused vigor with wisdom and fought evils.